we have this thing where we put ourselves in this block and say, this is who I am, and that's it. And we forget there are other components. And that there's, it's like an octopus. There's so many pieces to the puzzle. I'm not just a dancer. I'm a person first. I mean, I'm an artist. An artist has so many things. Considering, you know, like this pandemic, there's so many uncertainties. There's so many challenges that face everybody. And I think now we understand that this impacts everybody. Not this group. It's not a political statement. It doesn't have a race. It doesn't have a color. We're all affected in some way.
An economically poor situation for the most part. You know, my mother, she had a great job, but she had three kids. And where we lived, in order for us to be safe, you know, things were a little bit more expensive than what was normal. And so I grew up just in a family that understood the value of creating something out of nothing. And I feel like that has transferred into the way that I create dances, the way that I create and produce films. When I'm working with musicians on new original music, you know, what is this thing trying to be? What access to resources do we have? And then how do we create something out of what's being presented in front of us?
That was not my usual everyday rehearsals, I guess. Because working with you, it was going deeper than just the choreography itself, deeper than the movement. It was more about the feeling, about the story behind, about listening to the music, understanding what the artist wanted to say, what he wanted to transmit, and how that reflected in you, and how you will turn it into your own story and tell it back to the audience, like being real, being yourself. And that was different for me. That was a challenge though. But it was good, like a wonderful experience. It was fun. So my full name is Jorge Luis Arceo Curbelo. I'm a principal dancer with the Tallahassee Ballet, been with the company for like 6-7 years now. My mom was moving from Cuba, and She has a daughter in Miami, my sister, and I didn't necessarily want to live in Miami, but I wanted somewhere close. So Tallahassee was a good place, I guess, and I just moved here. You know, Christopher Huggins, he's a renowned choreographer, he was working with the company at the time, and he knew me from back in LA. He's a really good friend of mine, and somehow some friend of mine who was related to Janet, the CEO of the company, they talked to them about me, and they kind of like tried to like somehow like tried to connect with me, but they couldn't really until they met Christopher, and they asked him about me, if he knew me, and he's like, oh, absolutely, I've known him for like so many years, he's my good friend. So he talked to me about the company, and he basically was the one who brought
me. You talk a lot about your time with Mr. Mitchell in the Dance Theater of Harlem. Do you ever have moments when you're in the studio and you can feel Mr. Mitchell?
Every day. And especially those moments when things are challenging, like they all are with anybody. I say, I channel my Mr. Mitchell. What would he do? When I feel like I'm backed up against a door or a wall and not quite sure which way to turn, and then I have to just really rechannel myself and think about, okay, how do I do things differently? And also think, what's my focus? You know, the idea that this is a need, a want, and a desire. And also, too, the decisions that I make impacts everybody. And also, I always ask myself, this affects me how? Because what affects me affects everyone around me. Even more so with the younger dancers, it's important to establish that standard. Because me personally, I don't settle for mediocre. And I don't believe there's a certain age that you can start learning this and that. It's a part of what we do. It's the dance form that shapes us who we are today. There are baby steps. Every child develops differently and at a different pace. But at the same time, too, there's classroom etiquette and respect. Mm-hmm. And children want boundaries. And you start them at a very early age. Okay, it's been a while since we've touched this piece. It's called Reflections, remember? By Mr. Huggins, who set this a couple of weeks ago. And though you all have been on vacation, and also dealing with the pandemic and so many other things, but so now we've got to really regroup and get back to the studio, get focused again, and let's just do a run through. Let's see what happens, all right?
All right.
Okay, let's do it.
Thank you. Joyce Fizzoni, and I was director of the ballet company for about 20 years. I grew up in Atlanta, so I was part of a regional ballet company under Karen Conrad and Pittman Corey. And then I got my undergraduate degree in dance from University of Georgia. And my teachers were the first graduates from the School of Dance at FSU. So I followed in their footsteps and came here. Then I moved away for 8 years and came back and got involved with the ballet company, first as assistant director, then director, and then transitioned over to FSU after that.
My name is Megan Hellman. I have been at the Tallahassee Ballet for about 5 years, and I have been a teacher, the school director, photographer, rehearsal assistant, and ballet mistress. A little bit of everything. I found that the photography has given me a way to feel creative and still like I'm, it gives me more of that feeling like when I was dancing, you know, than teaching or doing other things. So I really enjoy that aspect of it. I'm always sort of game to jump in, jump into the fray and do whatever is needed and asked. So yeah, I have a tendency to jump in and help out wherever is needed and all the little places. You know, it was a scary time for the ballet. We were in the middle of rehearsing for our spring performances. Our school was getting ready for their recital and everything just came to a complete halt.
I don't think it hit me until weeks later, what the impact it was going to be. A little bit in denial, I guess. Yeah. But it's been great to see how the arts have handled all this.
One of the things that we have looked at from the beginning was how can we create a season and how can we keep our place in the community and stay active. I think it's a difficult decision right now for parents in the school and in any, you know, situation, whether it be their regular school or a dance school or their other activities is to make that choice and to feel like they're sending their children into a safe environment. So we've tried to do as much as possible to educate our families and let them know the precautions that we are taking here, and also to offer online options for all of the students so that, you know, those that are not comfortable or may have health issues that prevent them from coming into the studio still have access. Rehearsing Paquita, we were kind of starting out with a blank slate. Diego has only been with the ballet for about 6 months, and Catherine is a brand new dancer. So I had never worked with her before going into this process, and they had never worked together as partners before. So we were very lucky that they naturally synced very easily together, and they have a really nice timing dancing together. With any partnership in dancers, no matter what style they're doing, there has to be a level of trust. And these are two new dancers that haven't performed together before, so it takes a little bit of time for them to understand each other's bodies, get to know each other's timing, and just to trust that the other person is going to be there and ready when you need them to be. Diego's a wonderful partner, so that comes fairly easily with him, but making sure that Catherine is able to know that he's going to be there. And that they have their timing correct. So for example, just a simple lift, we have to make sure that the girl is jumping at the same time that he's prepared to lift. And that takes a little bit of rehearsal to sort of get them quite in sync. Performing with the mask is difficult because it's much harder to read facial expressions and for the dancers to really connect with the audience. Also, it's difficult, they're performing in a studio, which is a whole nother aspect than being on a stage and having a live audience. So having them get to the idea of feeling like they're in a performance space and being able to project and emote in that same way in a studio as they would on stage with hundreds of people watching. I think that the Tallahassee Ballet is sort of a little gem in this community. Our artistic director, Tyrone Brooks, who has just such a vast wealth of knowledge and experience that he brings into this company, and to have that in a small town like Tallahassee is a really special thing. And with that, he's able to bring in some choreographers, guest artists, and names that people wouldn't normally get to see and that the dancers here in Tallahassee wouldn't have the opportunity to work with. And it's been wonderful to see our students progress through the company and see them go on to do really special things. So I think it's a really special gem, you know, to have those performance opportunities for the audiences in Tallahassee, but also for our students and the dancers here, that they're able to experience that. full-length ballet.
Is that three?
So, I guess I should switch to English, right?
Yes. I came from Brazil in the year 2000 to pursue my doctorate at Florida State University. My name is Deluise Lima, and I have been the music director for the Evening of Music and Dance event for, I believe, about 15 years now. The moment I got here, I remember I wasn't even settled in my apartment. I got a call from my advisor, Dr. Carolyn Bridger, and she said, you know, there's this Evening of Music and Dance, and we get people from Florida State to play live music with dancers. Would you like to play a piece? We need somebody to play this piece, whatever piece it was. I'm like, sure, I was just getting here, and you know, I should play for whatever gig I have. So I agreed, and so I started my relationship with the Tallahassee Ballet as a hired musician to play for the Evening of Music and Dance. It's always so interesting and so delightful. We always try to decide on the repertoire way ahead, you know, in advance, and so that we can match the music and the choreographers feel comfortable with the pieces. And it has happened more than once that they come up with a piece of music that you can't find anywhere printed, and because I hire classical musicians, they have to have the music printed. And I've had to order, like a rush order for someone to listen to the music and transcribe that into paper so that we could do it. And sometimes it gets a little, you know, I get nervous because I'm like, is this gonna work? But the most amazing thing is that it's always great.
you know, the result. And we, by the time we get to stage and we are ready to perform, everything somehow falls into place, you know, and inevitably it's always beautiful performances. So I keep coming back year after year because it's so enticing, you know, it's challenging, but it's so beautiful in the end that you just cannot not do it.
You know? Wow, that was really, really nice. Really good. Yeah, that's it. No, you know, this is one particular place with the foot, you tap, really reach that thing of extending that leg, walk that, really reach, even more so. One more time. Tap it, reach it, that's it, yeah. There's another place too, like you enter. There's a place on the hill. There's a big hill. Something's always calling you, and then someone's always calling you from one way or the other. So let's sort of try that and just do it. Focus. Katarina.
Grau und
we've had the opportunity to get together on occasions with the company, and each time was very difficult because I felt like I was their father, and they were waiting for me to say, "Daddy, tell him it's gonna be okay," and there was nothing I could say. I'm getting ready to cry. There's nothing I can say. I always felt like they were waiting for me to say, and I was silent.
Este periodo tan extraño con el COVID-19 y todas esas cosas que han pasado de repente, es como que mi mundo se viró al revés. Como que tuve que respirar profundo, decir, ok, para un segundo, piensa qué es lo que está pasando, qué es lo que va a pasar ahora con tu carrera, con tu vida. Y va a ser un proceso, va a ser un proceso. Las cosas no van a ser como eran antes. Quién sabe si vas a poder bailar de nuevo. I mean, puede pasar. Suena loco, pero el mundo es una locura ahora mismo. Y te puedes ver en un futuro donde ya el baile no va a ser parte de tu vida. So, piensa cuál es el próximo paso. Es duro porque esto es lo que tú has hecho toda tu vida. Esto es lo que te ha levantado todas las mañanas, te ha dado algo para mirar al futuro y que ha traído miles de sonrisas, amarguras, pero que siempre ha estado ahí y ha sido el refugio tuyo cuando el mundo ha sido una locura. El baile siempre ha estado ahí. Y ahora con todo esto, puede que ya no esté. La vida sigue y hay más cosas. Tienes una familia que te quiere, personas alrededor tuyo que te adoran. Y aunque el baile es parte importante de tu vida, hay más cosas ahí afuera. Y todo está bien, porque así es la vida. Y te pasa a ti y le pasa a todos los que están alrededor tuyo y todo el mundo tiene que echar para adelante y sobrevivir. Eso es todo.
My name is Maxwell Van Huy. I am a violinist. My relationship to the ballet is my sister. She used to perform with the Tallahassee Ballet. And then I kind of got an invitation to help like play with the Tallahassee Ballet for a few events. And I've kind of been able to play with the ballet. So I've been playing the violin since I was about 4 years old. And I started trumpet in around sixth grade. So we had a trumpet at home. Then when I signed up for middle school band, I kind of thought, hey, this would be a great idea for me to try out. So, and I've fallen in love with that too. So I would say it took me about just like 1 or 2 days of just listening to like multiple recordings of like Louis Armstrong and other trumpet players playing it. And I think after like about a day or so, I was able to figure out the fingerings and all the expressive elements. I played with Jorge before on violin, but I've never like played with a dancer on trumpet before. So this was a completely new experience, but I thought it was actually pretty cool how it turned out. Sibelius Violin Concerto is like what like I've been working on for like most of the summer now. Because of COVID, I've never been able to play it like in front of more than a few people. So I thought, you know, this would be a really great opportunity to do so.
My name is Hope Altomi. I am a principal dancer with the Tallahassee Ballet. Before COVID, I was Mr. Brooks' assistant. And I also, before COVID, taught for the Tallahassee Ballet School. I got a job right after college with the Tallahassee Ballet. I actually worked for 1 year as the assistant to Rick McCullough, who is the artistic director before Mr. Brooks. That's how I got connected. And then after Rick left, I transitioned from being his assistant to being a dancer. And then I was a dancer for 6 years, and then after Mary Rebecca left, Mr. Brooks asked if I would be his assistant and took that on as well.
Are you still performing with the company?
I am not right now for a couple of different reasons. I'm 9 months pregnant, that's the big one. And then the other reason is because of COVID. I am rehearsing the trio, Katarina, Jorge, and Chris. It's not my choreography, it's actually Paige Center's choreography, another principal dancer with the company. When she was unable to do the rehearsals, she was like, you know, Hope, will you do this? And I'm just gonna like give you free rein, you know, like redo things that you need to redo, make it work for the camera or whatever. So yeah, so then I took that project on. It's been really awesome. Those three dancers are some of the three best dancers that we have in the company. Jorge is a principal. I've been partners with him like since we both joined the company. We've been partnering together. So my relationship with him is great just because we like physically know each other so well from dancing together for so many years. Chris is a soloist with the company. He actually also works for us for our business. My husband and I have a gardening business. And so I have a great relationship with Chris because he's not only my like dancer friend, but he's also like, he works for our like family business, which is cool. And then Katarina has been my friend since she came into the company. I got her a job with the law firm that she works with now. And I don't know, it's like family. Like literally, like it feels like working with family. I think the first thing that comes to mind is just to say, hi, mama. Wow. You've gone through a lot. Not just through COVID, but through the last few years have been hard. But let's refocus on the question. What has this time done for you as an artist? I think about COVID. I think about the kind of situation that the situations that you've been in your life, and also just man, how do I put it? It's like a traveling through a wilderness, right? Like you've traveled through this desert, and you've been figuring out how to bloom in the midst of it. You've been figuring out how to stay awake and alive. And I think you probably should be more proud of yourself than you are. You probably should should see how far you've come and take some victory laps or steps or whatever. Wilderness time is like really important for artists. I mean, it's important for anybody, but I think it's really important for artists. When you're able to like dive into pain and sorrow and not be embittered by it, you can connect and change, maybe not change, but you can connect with people's hearts deeper. And that's ultimately, I think, what people need, is to know that they are seen and loved when their hearts are broken. And you know what it's like to have a broken heart. Yeah, that's a gift to give to the world as an artist, as a mom.
Entendi.
Bom, vai ficar tudo bem? E você vai continuar com a sua vida firme e forte nos altos e baixos, como sempre aconteceu, mas sempre com Deus à frente de tudo, tomando conta de tudo. Graças a Deus você tem uma família que te apoia, que te ama, você tem amigos na sua vida e pessoas que se importam com você. Então fique tranquilo que vai ficar tudo bem. Eu sei que você tem muitos sonhos que você quer realizar. E com o tempo você sabe que você vai ser capaz de realizar tudo isso. É sempre ter foco, paciência e esperar o momento certo. Você sabe que você vai conseguir. Eu coloco Deus assim em tudo que eu faço e sempre vou continuar colocando Deus em tudo que eu vou fazer. Ele é o princípio, o meio e o fim da minha vida, de todas as coisas, e acredito muito nele. Tudo que eu tenho é graças a ele, a família abençoada que eu tenho, a carreira abençoada que eu tenho, todas as oportunidades que eu tive e que eu vou ter, eu sei que é tudo graças a ele. Então sempre ele vai estar junto de mim, vou sempre estar falando com ele, independente se esteja no Brasil, ou no Canadá, ou nos Estados Unidos, ou qualquer outro país. Eu sempre vou estar junto com ele, sempre vou ficar pedindo a ajuda dele, sempre, todas as horas. Muito trabalho árduo, muita dedicação, muita disciplina com as pessoas certas, nos lugares certos, que eu confio e acredito que vão estar sempre me deixando na minha melhor forma que eu possa estar. Eu não gostaria de ir para o Brasil agora, neste momento, mas não tem outra solução. Então, eu encaro isso de cabeça erguida, não tenho medo. E não é a primeira vez que eu estou voltando, sendo de férias ou não sendo de férias, não é a primeira vez que eu estou voltando para o Brasil. E eu sei que isso é apenas uma etapa, uma fase, e que isso vai passar. E assim que eu tiver a oportunidade, eu vou estar de volta. Então, estou confiante.
It's been pretty tough, like changing, it's like changing into a completely new job and like going a totally different direction than like where, like I moved up here to dance and it's like, now I'm doing something completely different, but it's like, hopefully we can get back to it.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I have another job and I enjoy it, but it's like just to get me by so I can dance more, and now the dancing isn't there, so it's like really heartbreaking. And I have anxiety about like keeping dancing without the studio and without the regimen of performance and rehearsal.
Yeah, I miss the stage, like the just being out there on the stage with the lights is like a, it was life.
it's like a rush and an experience like nothing else. So, and we're not going to be able to have that same thing this year. Hoping to be able to maybe just do some site-specific type things and move it outside when we have nicer weather, just so like we can keep dancing and creating and stuff.
Yeah. We're getting through this.
You've made it through 100% of your worst times. You'll make it through this one too.
Yeah, just gotta keep pushing.
Stay in the mindset and keep your body in shape and keep treating yourself with love. And yeah.
Yeah, don't give up.
Right.
I mean, it's been really great to get back in the studio and like rehearse again and having something that like we created, and it's like, it's comforting to like come back to that and like have some, you know, get back in that movement, because it's like, it's really comfortable movement as well. Like it's like, mm-hmm. It feels good and
feels natural.
Like to have, like be able to do it with somebody that you're like close with and like, no, it's like, it's pretty awesome. Cause like, I'm like, it's like, we're like roommates now. So.
Yeah. So since we're roommates, we can keep making pieces together.
Yeah. It really worked out.
Yeah. It worked out well.
So, okay, that might work.
Yeah.
So, if anything, We want to make sure that you continue to play throughout his turning the revolutions that he does at the end of the piece.
Okay.
Whatever happens, just keep playing until I say quit.
Okay.
Does that work?
Yes.
And Jorge, do you have any questions? I know this is new, this is the first time you're trying. Whatever, you know, the musicality is the same, the phrase work is the same. So just, I would consider this like a dance between the two of you, right? So you're playing off of each other. That is your mark, but don't feel like you have to stay stiff. Like, you can allow your body to breathe and move. Even consider it like a conversation between yourself and Jorge. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So you can play, and if there's anything that inspires you to move with your body, go ahead and allow your body to breathe.
Got it.
Is that cool?
Thank you.
Jorge, for now, I don't think that you should see him. He's not necessarily in your world.
Yeah, yeah.
It's more like he's like in a fishbowl. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's try it.
I came to the Tallahassee Ballet probably about 3 years ago when I learned that Tyrone was the new artistic director, and I just popped in to visit. I think it's hard for me to remember when I first started choreographing on the ballet. I think it was probably 3 years ago. I was invited to just create something new that I was playing with, and I wanted to look at the antebellum period in Louisiana and look at some of those race relations between the Creoles of color and the plantation owners, because there was a lot of mixed race that was happening during the antebellum period. So he gave me an opportunity to choreograph a ballet about that, and I did. Tallahassee Ballet, it was mentioned earlier today that it is the small gem that's been around for 47 years. I consider it a national treasure because every time that I've lived in Tallahassee, I've found a way to connect with it. Some of my mentors and peers have also found a way to connect with the organization. Many of us have taken class here. Many of us have come back to give and offer classes. It just feels like a hub in the middle of Tallahassee. Tallahassee used to be a very diverse city, and it was at least 20 years ago when I first came here. There was this like explosion of music and dance and cultural art. Back then, there wasn't a lot of community exchange that happening between Tallahassee Ballet and the larger cultural communities. But now, like Tyrone, he works often with different organizations at FAMU. I know Angelie Austin from FSU. She comes in and she brings students in to work with the company who also have their own extended networks. So for whatever reason, you find these different elements of cultural organizations that intersect with Tallahassee Ballet. Tyrone was my ballet professor over 20 years ago, and he was as colorful then as he is now. And I've always just enjoyed the storytelling that comes out of him when he's teaching. I'm a storyteller, he's a storyteller, and so I naturally gravitate to people like that. You know, Tyrone comes from the Dance Theater of Harlem. As a little girl, as a black girl, you knew of two major dance companies, the Dance Theater of Harlem and Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater. Those were the two companies that was always, as a young black dancer, in your face, right? So before I knew how vast the dance world really was, coming up in Southwest Louisiana, you know, to see other professional black dancers, professional black ballet dancers, was important to not only me, but to my mom and to my community. And to learn that Tyrone is a part of that lineage, you know, that for as a little girl, as a young college student, that like just blew my mind away, right? So I was learning about modern dance and a lot of modern dance choreographers I had never heard of. We were studying different types of choreography and movement I had never heard of. Some of it I didn't gravitate to. But in walks Tyrone Brooks, just full of life, full of personality, full of storytelling, and he was an excellent teacher, yeah? So I knew that I wanted to remain connected with him. When I became a faculty member at FSU in 2017, we really got close. We just started talking about the vision of the company. And, you know, it's one thing to talk about it, but it's another thing to walk the building and to see how people interact and engage with him. To see how when he walks into a room, the little kids, you know, their eyes light up, and to see their responses to him when he gives a note. So one day I was watching class, and the dancers were working on pirouettes. And if you don't know what a pirouette is, it's basically a turn. And so he was telling the dancers he could tell that he favored one side of the body. So he could tell that they favored turning to the right. And he was like, but you need to be able to turn on both legs, right? Right and left, both right, on the or on the don. And so the dancers were, you know, they kind of understood it, but not. And he was like, okay, listen, when you go to the store, do you buy one sock or a pair of socks? And the dancers were like, a pair. He was like, okay, great, so you need, it takes two. I need you to do two turns on both sides because it takes two. You can't have one sock. And it was so funny because they understood that they couldn't favor one side of the body. You know, over the past few days, we've been talking about, you know, how do you create a space or create a work where you're experiencing the full human, you know, where it's not just about a presentational ballet, but it is about dancers who have something to say and they're using ballet as the form to say it, you know? And I think, again, that's very rare. Oftentimes, that's a special and unique quality that comes from someone who has part of a lineage where they value that, right? Where they value storytelling, they value the full human. The piece that we were doing for Evening of Music of Dance, What a Wonderful World, that was actually created for the spring season, the 2020 spring season. But we weren't able to go into production because of the COVID-19 crisis. And I created three works for that particular concert. Tyrone approached me about revisiting that work for the fall because the other two pieces were ensemble pieces, right? So very large ensemble. And I can't remember how many dances, but it would have been too much to manage, I think, as far as safety and health against in the COVID-19 crisis. So yeah, we decided to rework with Jorge. And Tyrone told me what to choreograph too. He was like, you know, I'm thinking What a Wonderful World. What do you think? And I was like, sure. You know, I love Louis Armstrong. He's from New Orleans. I remember as a little girl, my mother playing that song on repeat. So there was something really nostalgic about it, even revisiting the music. So it was great. And Jorge is just such a brilliant mover and dancer and artist. So I knew that combination together would work. It's been hard. We lost a lot of family this summer, and then a lot of my friends lost their work. I graduated from film school, and we really didn't have a plan in place after graduation, and all of the projects that I had laid out, you know, were contingent upon major funding, and then when the crisis hit, that funding was gone. So I'm very scared. I decided to do this project because I really believe in Tyrone. I know what it's like to be the only one where you the only person culturally coming from another place, and to find yourself in a sea of people that don't look like you, who believe in you, but there's just a lot of nuance that comes from being different. I feel like this crisis that we have found ourselves in is helping us understand the disparities and the difference and what it's really going to take for us to deal with real things and to deal with each other. And I don't think we're close to being there, but I do feel like that people are experiencing really raw moments of truth telling and truth speaking, and that's important. And I'm exhausted. You know, we pulled this film together in 2 weeks because it was necessary and it needed to be done. But I'm tired. And in many ways, I feel like I can't breathe. But I trust my talent and I trust my strength and I trust my intellect. So I know that at the end of the day, I'm going to think of something brilliant. And I know that because of my connection to myself, my ancestors, my spirit, and to people, that we're going to find a way to pull together to make something brilliant and spectacular that will reach new audiences and reach other people in a way that it wouldn't have been able to happen had we done this in a live stage performance. Man, I just feel like I'm just carrying a lot of weight. And I think at some point, you gotta stop carrying all this weight.
And I was silent. And so that gets to me. But we're so fortunate because we have a group that understands. They understand. It's difficult. It's stressful. They understand. They understand what's happening, but they're still willing to come in and do the work with and having other jobs. And this is what's important. And to me, that speaks volumes about what's happening here. That keeps us together.
I've seen some really beautiful things over the last 2 days, and it's been really inspiring. You know, you've got dancers from other countries. Some can leave and some can't go. Some have been with their families, some have not. You've got directors that are, you know, been temporarily laid off, who are still giving 100%. You know, we're working on a shoestring budget to pull a film together. We're using cameras from people's homes. And, you know, thank God for education. Because we're just pulling all our education together to make this work. And I think that's just a testament to folks who believe in each other and who believe in organization. I don't think we want this organization to fold. We want it to be around, and we want other people to know about it.
Being optimistic. Being optimistic and just understanding and reminding myself it's going to be difficult. You know, there's going to be some red flags, but we got to get through this because it's like, you know what? I have to also remember, too, they're following my lead. If I fall apart, then everybody else will fall apart. Support the arts. We have such an incredible platform. You know, you can't do anything without the arts when you think about it. You turn on the TV, it's the arts. You turn on your radio. What is it that we do when we're at the lowest? What is it that we do? We listen to some music, a favorite piece of music, or you turn on your TV show, or you say, you know what, I think I'm gonna take in a movie. Or you may go to the park just to sit, and when you're sitting, what are you doing? You're watching the wind blow the trees. You're watching movement.
So watch the film.
Yeah, so watch the film.
I love you, thank you so much. That was so beautiful.
Thank you.